أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. How have you all been? Alhamdulillah, it's great. Firstly, I would like to praise and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving me this opportunity to be with you all here in Sri Lanka. This is my first trip, my first visit to Sri Lanka, and alhamdulillah, I have been, you know, seen a lot of wonderful things already. The brothers have been really hospitable to me, alhamdulillah, and it's just been really amazing experience so far. Alhamdulillah, in one day I've learnt a lot already. I've got another 3 more days to go and I hope I'll learn a bit more inshaAllah. Also, we should always praise and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything that He has given us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you this life, this gift of this life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you this life to be amongst the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Isn't this a great ni'mah? Isn't this a great blessing? That He has given you this Islam to be in the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Out of the 7 billion people in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen you. He has chosen me to tread the path of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. That is a great ni'mah, a great blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given each and every one of us. But how many of us are really appreciating this gift that Allah has given us? How many of us are really treading the path of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah? How many of us are literally going to that light that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us at the end of that tunnel? How many of us are reaching there? Or are we just named a Muslim? Just because my name is Abdullah, I'm a Muslim. Or is it because that you are following the deen how Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam followed it? That is a question that we need to ask ourselves. Are we following this great religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do we have those signs? Are we living the life of that perfect worshipper, of that perfect believer? That is a question that you and I need to ask ourselves. Hence the topic today is the life and signs of the perfect worshipper or the perfect believer in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Umar radiallahu anhu, he narrates a very beautiful hadith. He says, one day we were sitting with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions were there as well. We were sitting down. Suddenly a man entered the room. A man came. This man was wearing beautiful clothes. And he had thick black hair. And we've never seen him before. We've never seen this man before. Usually when you don't see a person in the same area, in the same locality, because Umar radiallahu anhu pretty much knew everyone. But he had never seen this man. So he thought he must be a traveler coming to them. But he said that he had no traces of a traveler on him. You know, usually a traveler in the desert, I mean, today we have the nice car and we have the air conditioner and we, you know, go to places. That time they were traveling on camel. They were traveling on horseback. They would get dusty. So he had no traces of a traveler on him at all. He came and he sat down next to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He put his knees on the knees of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he asked a couple of questions. He asked a few questions. He said the first question, what is Islam? What is Islam? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied that Islam is the 5 pillars. To the shahada, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to believe that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his slave and his messenger. Also, wa aqimu salah, wa atu zakah, wa sawmu ramadan, wa hajj al-bayt. So fasting, salah, for example, salah, the 5 daily prayers, giving zakah, fasting the month of Ramadan, and hajj to the haram. Now, the man said, sadaqta, you're correct, you're right. And then he said, what is iman? Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned the 6 articles of faith. To believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to believe in his angels, to believe in his books, to believe in his messengers, to believe in Yawm al-Qiyamah, and to believe in al-Qada wal-Qadr. And then the man said, you're correct, you're right. Then he asked, what is ihsan? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراه. To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if you are seeing him. And if you cannot think that, then know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is seeing you. He's watching you. Later on, he asked a few more questions. Later on, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the sahabas, do you know who this person was? They said, Allah wa Rasulullah a'lam. We don't know the Prophet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet know best. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that was Jibreel. And he came to teach all of you about Islam. What we learn from this hadith is the levels of faith. The levels of faith. The first level is to be a Muslim. To be a Muslim. That's the first level. The second level is to have that iman, mu'min. And the third level, the highest level, is to have the ihsan. And that is a muhsin. So what does it mean to be a Muslim? All of us, we all agree. To be a Muslim, we testify. We say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. We testify, we make this oath, we make this pledge. I'll give you a little scenario. I'm sure all of you work. And when you first went for that interview, you had that interview with your employer. The employer told you everything about this job. He asked you a few questions. Your employer was very happy with you. Very happy with your response. Very happy with your resume. Then your employer called you back and gave you a contract. You looked at that contract and your employer told you to look at it carefully, read the conditions, read the terms, read what you have to do, your job, and read the salary that we are going to pay. And if you agree to everything, you sign at the bottom. So you closely look, you look at everything, the salary, your job, everything is good, and you put in the signature. That signature is an oath that you are giving to your employer that you are going to fulfill the obligations. You are going to do that what your employer wants you to do. That's what you want to do, right? And in exchange, your employer is going to give you a salary. So you get something in return. When we say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, we are signing a contract. We have made an oath to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I am going to fulfill all the obligations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'm going to stay away from all the prohibitions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is an oath that you are making. Now sometimes in your job, you make some mistakes. You're a bit lazy sometimes, you're checking up Facebook and a few things you do, and your employer finds out. Your employer finds out. So he lets you go, okay, that's alright, next time don't do it. Then suddenly he catches you again, doing something wrong. And then he says, look, I'm going to give you a warning. Right, it's your last chance. If you don't behave yourself, if you don't do the job, you're out. You're going to get kicked out. Right? Then later on, you still do a mistake, you make another mistake, your employer says, come here, you're fired. That's it. You go, we don't want you anymore. Brothers and sisters, likewise in Islam, when you say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, you sign that contract. When you make mistakes throughout your time, you have time to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You repent to Him. You say, Ya Allah, forgive me for my shortcomings. Allah forgives you. Allah forgives you. Allah forgives you. But what if a time comes where you do not pray your salah? You completely, you know, you don't pray at all. You don't give your zakah. You don't fast the month of Ramadan, and then death approaches you. What happens? You have been fired from Jannah. Jannah is no longer halal for you. Unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives you in Yawm al-Qiyam. But can you imagine that when you say Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, that's the oath that you have given. That is the minimum requirement. The five obligations, the five pillars, is the minimum requirement to be a Muslim. How many of us don't even do the minimum requirements? That's a question we need to ask ourselves. The second level is Iman. Iman is, to be a mu'min, is a person who does all of those obligations, but he does it with sincerity and devotion. He does it with that fear, that hope, that love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is sincere in his actions. He takes time when he prays. He has full concentration while he prays. When he gives zakah or charity, he gives it because he loves to give. And he knows that Allah has something big for him in return. That's why he's giving it. But to be a Muslim is to make sure you complete those obligations. You might not have that full conviction, or you might not have that full sincerity, but at least you've done the action. That is to be a Muslim. To be a mu'min is higher than that. To do those obligations with that iman, with that firm faith and that firm belief, that sincerity and devotion. The next level is ihsan. And ihsan is a level where the sahabas reached. And it is not impossible to reach it, but yes, it requires a lot of determination and dedication. Ihsan is to do all the obligations, but do it in a manner that you are seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in front of you. In that manner. Now I want you to imagine you're in your workplace. You're in your workplace. And you're in the machine, you know, you're trying to fix up something, you're doing the job. And then your employer comes in front of you. And you quickly straighten up and you try your best to do the job. Because your employer is watching you. And you are seeing him. You're seeing him watching you. You try your best to make sure you do the best. Just for that little pay rise. Just for that employer liking you more. And you try your level best. That is because you're doing the action. Why? Because you are seeing your employer in front of you. Right? Now, to be a muhsin or to have the level of ihsan, it requires obviously a degree above that. Your employer is just an example that I'm giving. But to know that you are seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you're doing an action knowing that you are seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a different level. Is a level where your salah will be perfect. Is a level where your zakah will be extra good. It will be a level where when you give sadaqah, you will not care how the amount that you are giving. We know the story of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he wanted to give his whole, everything that he had. Why? Because he had that ihsan. He had that level of ihsan. But it is not impossible to reach. It requires a lot of dedication. That is to be a muhsin. My brothers and my sisters, this is from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you can find this hadith, the second hadith of Imam An-Nawawi, the 40 hadith of Imam An-Nawawi. Now, when we say we are Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us a few things in the Quran. For example, wa aqimu salat wa atu zakah. These different levels. You pray your salah, you give your zakah. This is to be a Muslim. To be a muhsin, again, is to have that determination, that faith, that love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to be a muhsin is to worship Allah as if you are seeing Him. And if you cannot, then know that Allah is watching you. Then know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching you. Now we know throughout time, a person's iman increases and decreases. We can't stay a muhsin every time or have that level of ihsan every time. It decreases as well. If we look throughout history, the prophets were sent to different nations and tribes. They were sent to different nations. What was the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent these prophets to these nations? The reason was that the iman decreased so much so that they started committing kufr. They started doing the acts of kufr. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send another Nabi. And then He will send another Nabi. And then He will send another Nabi. We know Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last and final messenger. And He was sent to mankind. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I have not sent you for any other reason except for the mercy to mankind. To mankind. Meaning after Him there is no other prophets. There is no other prophets. So if our iman is decreasing so much so that we are going into kufr, know that there is no other prophets to come to remind you. No more. His legacy is left behind. And that is the Quran and the Sunnah. That is the Quran and the Sunnah. That is the person who we are supposed to follow. Being a Muslim, a true believer. To have that sign of a true mu'min, to have that sign of a true worshipper, you need to follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You need to love him. You need to act upon what he did. You need to follow his footsteps. Today, if you ask, especially the youth, you ask them, who do you want to be like? Who do you want to imitate? Who is your idol? Who do you want to follow? What are the answers you get? I want to be like Justin Bieber. I want to be like Michael Jackson. I want to be like those One Direction boys. And they have their hair like that. They do the moonwalk. They do all sorts of things, crazy things. They want to be like them. They want to act like them. And that is the reality of today. That's the reality. Amongst the Muslims, I'm not talking about the kuffar. I'm talking about the Muslims. If you ask them, who do you want to be like, they will never say the Sahabas. Or most of them will not say the Sahabas. They will not say Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Where has that love gone? Where has that love gone? Where has that imitation gone? The imitating Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Imitating the Sahabas of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That love has to be there. And subhanAllah, I'll tell you a little story. While I was in Malaysia, I had a friend of mine. And he had family friends who lived in Malaysia. And his family friend, they had a newborn son. So they invited him, and my friend told me to come along because I had a car, he didn't have a car, it was a bit far, so we went. So we went to this place. We went to their house, and alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them with a baby boy. So we saw the baby boy, we had a good time, we ate, everything was good. So we asked the father, what did you name him? And just for your information, this was an Indian family. And you'll know why I say an Indian family. We asked, what did you name your son? So he said, we named our son Salman. And I thought, subhanAllah, what an amazing name. I was like, brilliant, that's beautiful. After Salman al-Farisi, a great Sahaba. A Sahaba, and I'm thinking this. A Sahaba who told Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam about the trench, to build the trench for the battle of the trench, battle of Khandaq. And due to that, subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Islam and the Muslims victory. And I thought, what an amazing name. And then my friend told and asked the father of the child, why did you name him Salman? What was the reason? And he said, I love Salman Khan. I love his movies. I love Bollywood. And he is my favorite actor. My wife loves him as well. And subhanAllah, all that good thought in my mind just went away. That is a problem, that's the issue. When we start imitating others, when we start imitating others, that is who you're going to follow. Where has that perfect believer gone? Where has that perfect believer gone? What is he teaching his children? So this is something we need to understand and have that love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We all claim we love Allah, correct? If I ask each and every one of you a question, do you love Allah? Everyone will say, you're crazy, we all love Allah. We all put our hand up. We all love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But how can we gain that love of Allah? Allah can love us as well. But how can we gain that love? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهِ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell the people, if they say that they love Allah, if you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَاتَّبِعُونِي, then follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you follow him, يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you. وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ, and not just love you, he will forgive you your sins. وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiving, the most merciful. What more do we want if Allah loves us? Today the Shaykh, the Khatib today, he talked about the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he even told us that if Allah loves you, what more do we want? That is what we want, that's the ultimate goal, to make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala love us. And the way we do that is we follow the footsteps of who? Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is a true believer. That is a true worshipper. That is a sign of a true believer and a true worshipper, to follow the footsteps of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If we can do that, Allah will love us. And what more do we want? Because we know when Allah loves us, what will He give us? He will give us Jannah. He will never tell a person whom He loves to go to Jahannam. But He will bring them and He will take them to Jannah. That is our ultimate goal. My beloved brothers and my sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us signs in the Quran of the perfect mu'min, the perfect worship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us in the beautiful surah of Surah Al-Mu'minun, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Quran, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قد أفلح المؤمنون الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون والذين هم للزكاة فاعلون والذين هم لفروجهم حافظون إلا على أزواجهم أو ما ملكت أيمانهم فإنهم غير ملومين فمن ابتغى وراء ذلك فأولئك هم العادون والذين هم لأماناتهم وعهدهم راعون والذين هم على صلواتهم يحافظون أولئك هم الوارثون الذين يرثون الفردوس هم فيها خالدون. Beautiful surah. Ayah 1 to 11 of this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes to us the perfect believer. The perfect believer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. That successful are those who are the mu'min, the believers. Who are they? الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Number one. And who are they? They are those who in their prayer, they have khushu, they have devotion. They have that love and that fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is a sign, number one, of the perfect mu'min, the perfect worshipper, the perfect believer. What is this khushu? Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentions, he says, the khushu of true faith is when the heart feels aware and humble before the greatness and glory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and is filled with awe, fear, shyness, love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and recognizes his sins. The khushu of the heart is then transferred to the body. That is khushu. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentioned this. Beautiful. How do we develop this khushu in our salah? Khushu is that devotion, that love. How can we develop that khushu in our salah? Now, if you are aware of tomorrow, as you know, we have the Prayer Makes Perfect course coming up. And I don't want to give a lot of it away, but I'll give some bits and pieces, inshallah, about the khushu in salah. And it's something very important that we need to understand. How we can develop that khushu in our salah. Number one, prepare yourself. Prepare yourself for salah. For example, take your time when you are doing wudu. As soon as your watch beeps for salah, as soon as your phone gives the adhan, you know salah is in. The time of salah is in. Take out all the worries of the world. Go to the bathroom. Go to the wudu area. Make your wudu nicely. Take time. When you prepare yourself properly, you have that khushu. Take time when you're making wudu. Wash your hands properly, your face properly. Make dua after your wudu. Go to your salah, pray nicely. That is all preparation for it. A lot of us, what we do is, we wake up 10 minutes before sunrise. And we go to the wudu area and we quickly wash ourselves. We don't prepare for ourselves properly for salah. If we do this, how can we develop that khushu in our salah? Number one. Number two, time. Make sure that you pray your salah on time. Do not delay it. When you pray your salah on time, you develop that devotion, that khushu in your salah. Because you have that time to pray. You have that time to pray. As soon as salah time comes, all the other worries has gone. Your focus is on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is where your focus lies. You go to the masjid. Or if you're at work, you go to your prayer place. And you put the musalla and you pray your salah on time. That is how you develop your khushu. Because you gave the importance of salah over worldly matters. That is how you develop it. Number three, clear the mind. When you are in your salah, make sure you are concentrating on your salah. Do not focus on any worldly things. Because in salah, you are talking to who? You are talking to your creator. You are talking to the person who has given you sustenance. You are talking to the person who has created you as a believer. That's who you're talking to. So why is it when you are talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we think of the worldly matters? And subhanAllah, it's amazing how the shaitan works. As soon as you go to salah, you say Allahu Akbar, you start thinking about your work. You start thinking, oh, my wife is waiting for me, I gotta go home. You start thinking about all of these things, my children are waiting for me. Shaitan is playing with your mind. That is the time where you clear your mind and focus on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Focus on the words of what you are saying. That's number three. Number four, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching you. Remember that Allah is watching you. That is a level of ihsan. Remember that. If you know that Allah is watching you, and remember the time where you're at your work and your employer is around or the camera is there, what do? You try your best to do the best. You try your best to make sure your job is perfect, just for that extra gain. Your boss will like you. So remember that in your salah, that your boss, who's your boss? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who created you, the one who will give you either Jannah or Jahannam, the one who gave you this Quran, the one who gave us Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is the one that we should be focusing on. He is the one that we should think that he's watching us. And that's true. He knows everything that we do. He knows what's in our hearts. And remember death constantly. In your salah, when you're remembering your death, your prayer automatically will be perfect. Because why? You might die tonight. You might die tomorrow. When you think of death, you will think that this salah is your last and final salah. And for that reason, you will pray perfectly. Imagine, you go to the hospital, you've got some problems. And your doctor tells you, you've only got 2 days to live. How perfect will your salah be? How perfect will your salah be after that? That's a question you need to ask yourselves. Know that death can happen at any moment. I had a cousin who was 16 years old and she passed away. 16-year-old cousin and she passed away. Death doesn't have a time limit and it can come at any moment. Number six, understand the recitation. Whatever you're reciting, know what you are reciting. When you are speaking to your employer, and I'm giving an example of an employer a lot because it makes sense. When you're speaking to your employer, you'll speak in the interview especially in the most sophisticated manner. You will try to use the best words to make him like you. Oh, this person is very smart. I think I better hire him. I think I better employ him. When you are talking in your salah, reciting the Quran, you are speaking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then you need to recite perfectly well. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Rahman, Rahim, Maliki, Yawmiddin, Iyyaka Na'budu wa Iyyaka Nasta'in. That's how we are reciting these days. We are speaking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Recite nicely and concentrate and know what you're reciting. Some of the ulama say that it is wajib, it's compulsory to understand at least what you are reciting in your salah. That's the amount of Arabic you should know. And some of the ulama say this. So we need to be very, very aware of it. Make a lot of dua in your salah. When you make dua constantly, you have that devotion. You have that fee. You have that khushu'. Number six, variety. Don't make your salah mechanical. You know, every time we pray our salah, and we always recite the same surah. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ. And we do this every time. We do this every time. We don't even think about it. Automatically in our lips, that surah comes because it's been so mechanical these days. Have a variety. Choose different surahs. In your sujood, make different dua. That's how you will not make your salah mechanical and you have that for sure. Remove the distractions. If you're praying and the carpet is distracting you, don't pray on that carpet. If you're praying and you can smell the food, oh nice, mashallah, chicken is cooking, and you're praying and you're hungry, where is that khushu going to go? The khushu is going to go in the meal. So, do not pray when you're hungry or do not pray when there's food out. Pray afterwards as per the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Lengthen your sunnah. Make it long, not your fard salah, because as Rasulullah mentioned, when you are leading the salah, you need to understand that there are elders behind you. But in your sunnah salah, your nawafil, lengthen it. Spend more time in it. And tahajjud. Tahajjud, you are focusing only on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're focusing on Him, correct? You're praying alone at night. No one is watching you. That's how you develop the main khushu. If you can do that in tahajjud, you can do that in every other salah, insha'Allah ta'ala. Number two, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. A mu'min is a person who does not have that ill talk, does not talk ill or bad. That is a person who stays away from it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اِجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ إِنَّ بَعْضَ ظَنِّ إِثْمٍ وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا وَلَا يَغْتَ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَوَّابٌ رَحِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions it beautifully in this ayah that we need to stay away from assumptions, assuming things. If we see someone doing something, we assume something else, but the reality is it's not that at all. And I've had that experience. I was in my university. A lot of the university students are not married. But I was an exception. I was married. And while I was there, I was sitting with my wife. We were studying together. There were a few brothers in the corner watching me. And they looked at me. Oh, look at these Westerners. Look at these Westerners. They think they can come here. They can flirt with girls. They can sit with whoever they want. You know, and they start spreading this rumor that this guy so-called Abdullah is sitting with a girl and they're studying together. When I found out about this, I went to them and I said, brother, do you want me to carry a sign saying that I'm married to this woman? So assumptions is very bad. And my wife also copped it a lot. Why are you always with this boy? Who is this person? My wife is like, do I have to carry a marriage certificate everywhere I go? Yani, do not assume bad things when you see something. Always think of something good. Do not spy on each other. A lot of people, they want to see a person doing something haram so they can spread the news. Do not backbite. Backbiting, Allahu Akbar. We know it's a major sin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emphasized so much. He said, if you tell the truth about a person, but he doesn't like it, that's backbiting. And if you lie about him, that's slandering. You can imagine the gravity of that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيْلُ لِكُلِّ هُمَّزَةِ لُمَزَةِ. Wail is what? Curse be upon those. Woe to those. Or also a place in hellfire. To those who backbite and mock others. You know what mocking means? Or just ishara on your face. What's the ishara? A person is walking, you don't like him, you're talking to a friend, you're like, look at this guy. You know, just that ishara is also part of humaza lumaza. That is something we need to understand. Also, my brothers and my sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِلزَّكَاةِ فَاعِلُونَ. They are those, the mu'min are those who give the zakah. They give that charity. And they give it with submission. They give it with devotion. That is a person who is a true believer, a true mu'min. And charity is something very hard sometimes. When you're giving charity in your mind, you're thinking my money is getting less and less and less. That's what you have in your mind. But the reality is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase your wealth, number one. Number two, He will give you more in Jannah, insha'Allah ta'ala. Sometimes we take the hadith literally. You know, in the hadith, Allah Rasul sallallahu mentioned, give from your right hand and your left hand doesn't know. So we don't put our hand in that pocket and give it from this hand. No. It means that you're giving in secret. No one else knows how much you've given. If you can do something like that, that is sincerity. That is a true believer. It doesn't mean that you can't give charity in front of people. No. If it means to encourage others, that's perfect. But the best charity is when you are giving in secret. That's the best. And if you can do something like that, that is a sign of a true believer. Also, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those who guard their private parts, those who guard themselves, you know, from the pleasures of this life. And what is that? The women to the men. And for those of you who can guard your private parts, they have that sign of a true believer. And we know the story of Yusuf alayhi salam. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, if we did not guide Yusuf, he would have fallen into the trap. So we are human beings, we are men. We're created in such a way that desires are out there. And so much so, it is something very hard to do, to stop yourself. Allah, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa says that a person who will be under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is when he is approached by a young, beautiful woman who has status and she says to you, do whatever you want with me. And you say, I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's very hard to do. But if you can do that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you shade in Yawm al-Qiyamah. Allahu Akbar. So that is something we need to understand and be wary of. That a true believer is a person who guards himself. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ وَعَهْدِهِمْ رَاعُونَ. A person who is entrusted and he keeps that trust and he keeps his promise. We know the signs of a hypocrite. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us there are three signs of a hypocrite. What are they? A person who speaks and he lies. A person who a promise is made and he breaks his promise. And a person who is entrusted with something, he breaks that trust. Do not be a hypocrite. We know where hypocrites are going to go. Where are they going to go? فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. They are the people who will be the lowest grade of hellfire. So a person who is entrusted with something, make sure you keep that trust. So let's say, if a brother comes to you, and he says, Akhi, I have a problem. My wife and I were having some issues. But please don't tell anyone. I just want some solutions. What do I do? And this brother goes around spreading the news. You know this brother Khalid, he's having a problem with his wife. He's about to get divorced. It's great news. It's all over, CNN. SubhanAllah. This is what is happening. A person who breaks that trust, he has a sign of a hypocrite. And if you promise something, you say, Mom, Dad, I promise I'm going to do this for you. I'm going to promise I do that for you. And you break that promise. You know you can do it, but yet you break it. That is a sign of a hypocrite. A person who keeps that promise, a person who keeps that trust, he has that sign of the perfect worshipper. He has a sign of a perfect worshipper. Also, again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? That he maintains his salah. Remember, Allah already reminds us about salah. Again, he reminds us about salah. A person who prays but maintains his salah, prays on time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيْلُ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ. Woe to the ones who pray. Not to the ones who don't pray. Woe to those who pray, but they are heedless of their prayer. They don't pray on time. They don't pray on time. Or they delay their salah so much so that they have only 5 minutes to pray. Or they have no khushu in salah. They pray like the pecking crow. That's how they pray. But they pray. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, woe to them. What about the people who don't pray at all? What about the people who don't pray at all? That's something to think about, brothers and sisters. What happens to these people? أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْوَارِثُونَ الَّذِينَ يَرِثُونَ الْفِرْدَوْسَ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. They, these signs, people who have these signs of a mu'min, they are the inheritors. Inheritors of what? Inheritors of Jannah. الَّذِينَ يَرِثُونَ الْفِرْدَوْسَ. Firdaus. That is the people who will enter Firdaus. SubhanAllah. I would like to end it with a story. A story of a Sahabi who shows that love, that devotion of that perfect worship. This Sahaba, his name is Sawad radiallahu anhu. In the battle of Badr, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was lining the ranks. You know how in Salah you straighten the rows? Also in the battlefield, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was straightening the rows. Sawad radiallahu anhu was a stocky man. So he was sort of in front of the row, while the others were behind. So he was a bit ahead. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to him and sort of pushed him to make sure the line is straight. When he pushed him, Rasulullah ﷺ was holding a weapon, right? And it hurt him. It hurt him. Sawad said, Ya Rasulullah, you hurt me. I want to retaliate. I want to take revenge. An eye for an eye. An eye for an eye. Imagine a commander did that today. He will punch you in the face and tell you to go away. Rasulullah ﷺ exposed his chest. And he said, retaliate. Sawad radiallahu anhu. He hugged Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he kissed his chest. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Sawad, what are you doing? Sawad said, Ya Rasulullah, you can see what's going to happen. I'm going to die in this battlefield. I want my last moments to be my skin touching your skin. I want that last moment. I have that love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I have that love for Islam and I want to sacrifice myself for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But my last moments to be my skin touching yours. That is a true worshipper, a true believer in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is a sign of a true mu'min. Brothers and sisters, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us those signs of a true believer. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us true mu'min and give us that level of becoming a muhsin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all insha'Allah ta'ala. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather us like we are gathered here insha'Allah in Jannah. وجزاكم الله خير قولوا قولي هذا واستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم. We have a bit of time, so if any one of you on the topic want to ask some questions, inshallah you may do so. Any one of you have any questions on the topic, inshallah I'll try my level best to answer the questions for you. I hope that was clear. Did everyone understand? I hope my accent wasn't a bit weird. Trust me, the British accent is worse. The British accent is worse. If he speaks, you won't understand at all. No one has any questions? Yeah. Okay. If you are praying and you get this whispering of the shaitan in your ear while you're praying, what should you do? Who knows the answer? I want to ask you guys. Who knows the answer? Yes. So if you turn your head to your left and you spit, what about the brother catches your spit? Huh? The light spit. Okay. Rasulullah ﷺ said in a hadith, and the Sahabas also mentioned this, that in your salah, you may do so. You may do so is what? You turn to your left and you spit 3 times. Not spit literally getting all the saliva out. But some of the ulama say that do this in your sunnah salah only. Don't do it in your fara'id. Don't do it in your fara'id. Why? Because the brother next to you will be concerned. Right? You might, the spit might go there. And also some of the Sahaba says that's extra movements in your salah. So do not do that in your fard, according to the ulama. But in sunnah salah, there isn't an issue, inshallah. Any other question? Sorry. In our fard prayer, can we make dua in sajda? Excellent question. In your salah, while you are praying in your fard prayer, and you are in your sujood, can you make dua? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged to make dua. He encouraged it. If you know the imam is going to prolong the sajda, make dua as much as you can. But there is a condition. The condition is, it must be in Arabic. In your fard salah, the dua in sujood or even in ruku should be in Arabic. Now I'm sure all of us know many dua. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. But the ulama, they say, that's just one example. The ulama say, if you don't know Arabic, you can read this dua, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَا, because this dua is generally for everything, right? So you're asking Allah, oh Allah, give me the good of this world and the good of the hereafter. And think in your own language what you want from Allah in your fard salah. Because Allah knows what's in your heart. But we know that when we speak in salah in a language other than Arabic, if we speak in salah, in fard salah, a salah can be batil, it can be broken. But according to a lot of the other ulama, they say that in your sunnah salah, it is fine. This is according to a lot of the other ulama, they say in your sunnah salah, it is fine. But in the fard, it has to be in Arabic. Any other questions? Clarifications about the topic? Inshallah, if you attend tomorrow, I'm hoping all of you will attend, inshallah. It is a course, Prayer Makes Perfect. And this course, we will be discussing every issue about salah, inshallah. We'll try our best in 2 days, whole day. So spare the weekend, inshallah. Come to the course, learn about the salah. The salah, the differences of opinions in salah, for example. You know, a lot of us have problems. A lot of us have a lot of problems in salah. I don't know about this country, but in my home country, which is Fiji, where I was born, if you make raful yadain, right? If you make raful yadain, they might smack you on the face. Because they know only one way. They haven't been exposed to the others. So it's best to know many other ways. My uncle was telling me once in Fiji, he was making raful yadain, and another person said, was there a lot of flies around your ear? Why are you always, you know, spotting your ear? Because they don't know. So it's good to know and learn about salah from the different madhahibs. Imam al-Shafi'i, for example, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmed bin Hanbal. We should know the sunnah of salah, the wajibat of salah, the fara'id of salah, the pillars of salah. We should know the prerequisites of salah. All of these things we'll be discussing. We'll be discussing about the adhan. We'll be discussing about the iqamah. We'll be discussing the manner of walking to the salah. We'll be discussing in great, great detail, inshallah. So for those of you who can come, inshallah, I'm pretty sure there are still seats available. Yeah. So if you do want to come, join, inshallah. It'll be a benefit to all of us. Any other questions that you guys have? Yes. Yeah. All right. That's a good question. That's a really good question. It's actually a bit of a controversial question, right? okay. To be clear on this, to be a ma'mum, who's a ma'mum? A person who prays behind the imam. What is his duty? His duty is to follow the imam, correct? His duty is to follow the imam. If the imam goes to ruku and you are reciting something, the scholars are in agreement that you go to ruku. You follow the imam. Why? Let's say, for example, you are praying salah. The imam is praying, the jama'ah is praying. And they go to ruku. And you came and you joined the salah in the ruku. Is your first raka'ah valid? Yes or no? If you join the imam in ruku, is your raka'ah valid? It's valid. Have you prayed surah Fatiha? No. Have you prayed another surah after that? No. So the ulama, they say that the imam recited for you. This is according to majority of the ulama. But if you are in salah, especially Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah or the Shafi'i madhab, they say that if you're in salah, you need to recite surah Fatiha as well. You need to recite Surah Fatiha. And that has a basis for it as well. There's hadith on that. There is a hadith on that. But there's no salah if Fatiha is not recited. So there's basis on that. But Imam Abu Hanifa, he says that the salah of the Imam, his recitation is your recitation. So whatever he recites, you don't have to recite. We'll be discussing that tomorrow as well, inshallah, in great detail. So, the conclusion is, if the Imam goes to ruku and you are still reciting, it is better for you to go to ruku with him. Even if you have to cut your qira'ah. Even if you have to cut your qira'ah. Because you need to follow the Imam. You can't wait until the Imam goes, Sami'a Allahu liman hamidah, and you haven't gone to ruku first. Right? So that's something we need to understand. Yes, in the salah of khawf, salatul khawf, that's different. Salah, the fi salah. Right? For example, you're in a battlefield and the enemy is in front of you, then there is a different method of praying. There is a line up front, line at the back. And when the imam does sajda, the first line does sajda while the back stays there and watches, waits if there's any attack. That's different. So I hope that's clear, inshallah. We'll discuss it tomorrow more in detail. It's almost Isha time. Any other clarifications? Khair, inshallah. I think we'll end it there. Wa jazakumullahu khair. I hope that was beneficial, inshallah. And we'll make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives us the understanding of salah, the understanding of being the perfect believer. And I hope, inshallah.